Hello students, welcome back to the science class. In this video, you're going to learn about the genetic technology. So please watch this video until the very end to find out more about what genetic engineering is. So without further ado, let's begin our lesson.
Imagine you're alive back in the 1980s and we're told that the computers would soon take over everything, from shopping to dating and the stock market, that billions of people would be connected via a kind of web, that you will own a handheld device orders of magnitude more powerful than supercomputers. It would seem absurd, but then all of it happened. Science fictions became our reality that we don't even think about it. We're at a similar point today with genetic engineering. So let's talk about it, where it came from and what we're doing right now. And about a recent breakthrough that will change how we live and what we perceive as normal forever. Humans have been engineering life for thousands of years. Through selective breeding, we strengthen usual traits and plants and animals. We became very good at this, but never truly understood how it works, until we discovered the code of life, deoxyribonucleic acid, DNA, a complex molecule the guide of the growth, development functions, and the productions of everything alive. Information is encoded in the structures of the molecule. Four nucleotides are paired and make up a code that carries instructions. Change the instructions and you change the being carrying it. As soon as DNA was discovered, people tried to tinker with it. In the 1960s, scientists bombarded plants with radiations to cause random mutations in the genetic code. The idea was to get the useful plant variations by pure chance. Sometimes, it actually worked too. In the 70s, scientists inserted DNA snippets in the bacteria, plants, and animals to study and modify them for research, medicines, agriculture, and for fun. The earliest genetically modified animal was born in 1974, making mice a standard tool for research, saving millions of lives. In the 80s, we got commercial. First patent was given for a microbe engineered to absorb oil. Today, we produce many chemicals by means of engineered life, like life-saving clotting factors, growth hormones, and insulin, all things we had to harvest from the organs of animals before that. The first fruit modified in the lab went on sale in 1994, the flavor-saver tomato. A tomato given a much longer shelf life for an extra gene that suppresses the build-up of rotting enzymes. But GM food and the controversy surrounding them deserve a video of their own. In the 1990s, there was also a brief foray into human engineering. To treat maternal infertility, babies were made to carry genetic information from three humans, making them the first humans ever to have three genetic patterns. Today, they are super muscle pigs, fast-growing salmons, featherless chickens, and see-through frogs. On the fun side, we make things glow in the dark. Fluorescent zebra fish are available for as little as $10. So, the aim of genetic engineering is to remove a gene or genes from one organism and transfer it to another so that the gene is expressed in its new house. The DNA that has been altered by this process and which now contains a length of nucleotides from two different organisms is called recombinant DNA. The organism which now expresses the new genes is known as a transgenic organism or a genetically modified organism or GMO. There are many different ways in which a GMO may be produced, but these steps are essential. First, the gene that is required is identified. It may be cut from a chromosome made from the mRNA by these first transcriptions or synthesized from nucleotides. Second, multiple copies of the genes are made using the technique known as the polymerase chain reactions or PCR. Third, the gene is inserted into a factor which delivers the genes to the cells of the organisms. Examples of the factors are plasmids, viruses, and liposomes. Fourth, the factor takes the gene into the cells. Fifth, the cells that have the new genes are identified and cloned. To perform these steps, the genetic engineer needs a toolkit consisting of, first, enzymes such as restriction endonucleases, ligase and reverse transcriptase. Second, factors including plasmids and viruses. Third, genes coding for easily identifiable substances that can be used as markers. Tools for the genes technologies. First, restriction enzymes. They are also known as restriction endonucleases. These enzymes cut the sugar phosphate backbone of DNA at specific places within the molecules. Each restriction enzyme binds to a specific target site on DNA and cut at that site. Here is the table of the four restriction enzymes and their target sites. Restriction enzymes either cut straight across the sugar phosphate backbone to give a blunt end, or they cut in a stagger fashion to give sticky ends. Look at these pictures below to look at the difference between blunt ends and sticky ends. Blunt ends is a straight cut down through the DNA that result in a flat pair of bases on the ends of the DNA. Sticky ends is stagger ends of a DNA molecule with short single-stranded overhangs. Sticky ends are more favorable in genetic engineering because they can easily form hydrogen bonds with complementary sequences of bases on other pieces of DNA cut with the same restriction enzymes. Second, ligase enzymes. The enzyme DNA ligase is used to link together the sugar phosphate backbones of the DNA molecule and the plasmid, producing a closed circle of double-stranded DNA containing the new genes. Third, factor. Factor is a DNA molecule used as a vehicle to artificially carry foreign genetic material into another cell, where it can be replicated and/or expressed. A factor containing foreign DNA is called recombinant DNA. Examples of the factors are plasmid, viruses, or liposomes. A plasmid is a small circular double-stranded DNA molecule that is distinct from a cell's chromosomal DNA. A virus is a small infectious agent that replicates only inside the living cells of an organism. Liposomes are intracellular vesicles that can be used to transport substances such as nutrients and drugs into the cells, out of the cells, and between different parts of the cell. Fourth, genetic markers. Genetic marker is a gene used to determine if a nucleic acid sequence has been successfully inserted into an organism's DNA. Examples of genetic marker are, first, antibiotic resistant genes, 2, fluorescent substances, 3, enzymes beta-glucuronidase, 5, promoters. Promoter is the regions of DNA to which RNA polymerase bind as it start transcriptions. Transcriptions is the first of several steps of DNA mass genes expression in which a particular segment of DNA is copied into RNA by the enzyme RNA polymerase. This picture shows the promoter. The promoter not only allows RNA polymerase to bind to DNA, but also ensures that it recognizes which of the two DNA strands is the template strand. The promoter can be said to control the expressions of the genes and can ensure a high level of gene expression. Insulin productions. What is insulin? Insulin is a hormone made of the pancreas that allows your body to use sugar or glucose from the carbohydrates in the food that you eat to form energy or to restore glucose for future use. People with diabetes mellitus cannot produce insulin, so they are treated with insulin extracted from the pancreases of cattle or pigs. Insulin production from pancreases of cattle or pigs takes time and only produce small amount of insulin. The step to produce insulin by genetic engineering. First, insert the human insulin genes into the plasmid. Second, return the plasmid to the bacteria. Third, put the recombinant bacteria in large fermentation tanks. Fourth, there, the recombinant bacteria use the genes to begin producing human insulin. Fifth, harvest the insulin from the bacteria. Sixth, purify the insulin for use as medicines for people.
I think that's all about our lesson today. Don't forget to do the SSS on the water. Bye!